But when you mistake a map for the world, you've made a huge error, and I believe that's where we now are. These seem to me the primary paths to reality. One is science, another is reason, a third is imagination, and a fourth is intuition. And we live in an era in which imagination and intuition have been sort of tarnished as false.
Hello and welcome to the Science Fiction Podcast with Damian Walter. Long-term listeners to the podcast will have followed our evolving journey in what we're talking about when we talk about science fiction. So sometimes the Science Fiction Podcast is a fan cast for Denis Villeneuve and his upcoming June 2 movie. But we're also trying to discuss the what happens when science and fiction meet, these apparently very two opposite things. Science, which is all about the facts and realities of our world, and fiction, which is all about the stories. And we've encapsulated this in our logo with a series of words that represent something of a duality. So science and fiction, reality and fantasy, reason and emotion, and mythos and logos. And I'm incredibly honored today to be joined by, I think, the leading thinker in the world about this apparent division that runs through our culture, that seems to run through humanity, and that seems to run really down the center of our brain and the two hemispheres of our brain. So I'm really happy to welcome Iain McGilchrist. Hello and welcome, Iain.
Oh, thank you, Damien. I'm delighted to be here.
Well, thank you for joining me. It is literally a tremendous honor. I've spent dozens and dozens of hours listening to you on other people's podcasts and to your audio explorations of your most recent book as well. I wonder if I can ask you, I hope this isn't a left field question for you, and it would be totally okay to say no, but do you have any relationship to science fiction? Would you say you're a science fiction fan? Some people really dislike science fiction, and if that was you, that would be fine as well. That would be an interesting direction.
No, I mean, I certainly don't dislike science fiction. I don't know a lot of science fiction. And one of the sad things about the last 30 years is that I've had to keep up with so many science and philosophy books that I haven't really had much time for reading things that are sort of perhaps more tangential, but nonetheless important. There are some works of science fiction that I consider of colossal status, and one is Stanislaw Lem's Solaris. And I think that Tarkovsky's exploration of it is extraordinarily, inexhaustibly deep. I've seen it many, many times. I've also seen the other film called Solaris, made in America, but it was so disappointing that I don't refer to it anymore. But there's that. And I've also been reading something that probably isn't science fiction exactly, which is C.S. Lewis's... He did a three-part trilogy, and I've only read the third part, which is called That Hideous Strength. And it is a kind of science fiction, but it's also very much a sort of mythology, and it's very powerful and very prescient, by the way. I mean, in 1945, or whenever he was writing it, he was foreseeing things that have happened recently.
Fantastic. That was one of my introductions to science fiction. And yes, I would definitely say that Lewis's space trilogy is science fiction.
Yes.
And also, of course, theological as well. And
as always,
definitely creating a myth for the future, which is one of the ways that I discuss science fiction. I talk about science fiction as modern myth making.
Yes.
So Tolkien I mean, generally considered a fantasy writer, but fantasy and science fiction are very related, and he had his ideas of mythopoeia, the creation of myths for the world. And I was hoping that we would explore some of this overlap with myth and science fiction between us today.
Absolutely, yes. Well, as you know, because you've read my work, mythos the ancient Greek was prior to and more important than logos, from which we derive the word logic. I mean, logos didn't mean logic in those days. It meant things that were more explicit. It meant things that you could argue for in a court of law or, you know, in a debate. But mythos was the only way of encapturing the really serious, important, emotional, philosophical thoughts about the world that are hard to put into everyday language, but are nonetheless important for that.
And we seem to live in a time where, for a long time, especially in Western culture, we seem to maybe deny mythos, to say it wasn't significant to us anymore. We could be a culture purely of logos, and I know we're going to get more into this with your ideas. But then I see the way that our attempt to do that was completely futile, because the mythos, it is really more powerful than we are, and it just exploded out again. And one major way of that happening was science fiction and the huge popularity of course, things like Star Wars and Star Trek, but movies like 2001, and of course the popularity of writers like Lewis, who make this explicitly theological as well.
Yes, yes. Your expression, "it's bigger than we are," is rather important, I think. There's a sense in which these things are not made up, but are permitted by us to come to expression. And when one is writing the most difficult to express things, and certainly poetry, of which I have a little experience, one feels that something is writing through you. It's not that it doesn't use you and take part of you into it, but it's not just coming out of you. That's the very strong feeling one has. And so many artists and writers have reported very much the same phenomenon.
Yeah, absolutely. I think we'll get to that in one of my questions. I don't want to preempt too much here. What I'd like to do for my listeners is discuss your work, for which you're best known, which is articulated in two books, The Master and His Emissary in 2009 and The Matter with Things in 2021. Both very significant books. I think I've cropped up a couple of times in your live events as the person who said that The Matter with Things is a 3.5 pencil book to get through it and deal with all of the questions that come up. And the complete works of Shakespeare is only 2.5 pencils. but would it be fair to say that The Master and His Emissary is your thesis of the dual hemispheric model, and then The Matter of Things is the extended philosophy?
I think that's a good way of putting it. The only thing I would add to that is that I explored literature that wasn't available when I first was writing The Master and His Emissary. And so in The Matter with Things, I include a great deal more neuropsychological evidence. I think it's about 6,000 papers and sources that are referred to there. So nobody can say there's no evidence. Wow. That doesn't stop some people saying that without having looked at my books. But I'm trying to get beyond that. So yes, it is. And it's saying what the philosophical import of all this is.
In a second, I'm going to ask you to give your summary, I guess, which you must be very used to doing by now.
Yes.
I think one of the important points is that this does have these very deep roots in scientific research in various areas that you have crossed into. So that separates it from the kind of the pop culture idea of hemispheres.
Yes.
Which people are quite familiar with and then have also heard is no longer valid.
Yes.
So that's something to say that this goes significantly beyond that idea.
Yeah.
And also it has a lot of similarities to a long history of thinking about the world that we might think of through the mythos or even through religions or and perhaps even ideas today like you've talked with people about John Vervaeke, about meaning and so on. So it crosses into all of these areas, but yours seems to be the most scientifically rigorous of them. Is that fair, do you think?
I think so, yes. And it's not only that I, you know, take up this unpopular issue of hemisphere difference, but I come to quite different conclusions from the ones that made their way into popular culture. So the first hurdle I always have to get over is, oh, all that stuff about hemispheres was exploded long ago. It's pop science and it's nonsense. Well, it's true that most of, not all, but most of what was said about hemisphere differences was wrong. But perhaps I could explain what I think is important about the difference.
Please do.
Yeah.
Please do, yeah.
First of all, it's a very evolutionarily verifiable hypothesis, if you like. The idea is that the two hemispheres of the brain evolved differently, not just in human beings, but in pretty much all creatures we've looked at, to solve a particular problem, which is how to pay two kinds of attention to the world at the same time. One kind of attention is required for survival in the simplest sense, that we need to get stuff. We need to grab food, we need to catch a rabbit, we need to pick up a seed, whatever it is. And we need also to be able to manipulate our environment, to pick things up and build things and use tools and so on, in the case of human beings. So, in fact, as far back as we can go in history, 700 million years, we know that the neural networks that form the ancestors of the human brain were asymmetrical, which is interesting in itself. Why were they asymmetrical? And I think the reason for this was that, as I say, two kinds of attention need to be paid. One is the one with which we grab things, and this is the one subtended by us, in us, by the left hemisphere. And it therefore pays attention to something that we already know what it is, we know we want it, and we need to get it. And so it focuses in a targeted way, a very narrow beam of attention that brings clarity. But the difficulty with this is that it is not seeing everything else that's going on at the same time. And so in order to survive, you also need to be looking out for predators, not just predators, but also for your kin, for your offspring, for your mate, for your kind. And to do this, you need precisely the opposite kind of attention, maximally open, undedicated yet as to what it may find, and broad, sustained, and on the lookout, vigilant. So very different from this attention. I know what it is, I want to get it, it's a detail. The right hemisphere is looking out for the whole of the rest of it. So the one thing that was probably true about what people used to say was that the left hemisphere had a narrow attention and the right hemisphere a broad attention. And that's not disputed by anyone in the world. I mean, it's a very well-attested fact. But what people were not aware of so much was that attention creates the experiential world. What we find to be there depends on the kind of attention we pay. And there are many amusing experiments that have been done in recent years showing that we're completely blind to something we don't expect to see. What follows for me is that these kinds of attention give rise to two different kinds of phenomenological worlds. What are they like? In a nutshell, the left hemisphere sees things that are already known, familiar, fixed, isolated, fragmentary, decontextualized, and examples of a kind, a category, not unique, but, oh, it's one of those. And this kind of abstracted thinking is a useful tool, but it's not very good for constructing reality. The right hemisphere sees something much more complex. It sees a world in which nothing is completely fully known, is never completely fixed, is never completely isolated, but is ultimately in connection with everything else. It's flowing, it's changing, it's often implicit. The right hemisphere is much better, sorry, this is my right hemisphere, at picking up the stuff that is hard to detect with the kind of conscious mind. So small changes in expression in the face aspects of tone of voice, irony, metaphor, the language of poetry, the language of myth. It's much better at understanding the meaning of a story, whereas the left hemisphere sees it as simply a sequence of vignettes. It doesn't understand the overall import of what's going on. So those are really quite different worlds. And my thesis is that the world that we're in now has come to depend very heavily on this very simple, mechanistic, theoretical vision of the world. A distinction I like to make is between presence and a representation. And a representation means literally present again after the fact, when it's actually no longer present. So the world is present in all its richness and complexity and intuitive meaning that can never be fully grasped to the right hemisphere, which is an expert at decoding it. And the left hemisphere instead replaces reality with its own simple map of reality. Now, a map is not to be despised. A map is very useful. But when you mistake a map for the world, you've made a huge error. And I believe that's where we now are. I'd just like to add that in the ways in which we can come to a sense of what we can rely on, we need to be using, I would say, at least four things. These seem to me the primary paths to reality. One is science. Another is reason. A third is imagination. And a fourth is intuition. And we live in an era in which imagination and intuition have been sort of tarnished as false. But actually, science and reason can lead you to false conclusions unless they are sophisticated by imagination and intuition. And indeed, when you come to look at, as I have done, the stories of many great findings by mathematicians and scientists, they made these discoveries not by pursuing the scientific method as such, but by having a broad attention which saw new shapes, new forms, new, as the Germans say, Gestalten, which are holes that cannot be decomposed into their parts without loss. And in each of these paths, science, reason, intuition, and imagination, the right hemisphere plays the bigger part. It is actually more intelligent. It sees more. Its emotional and social intelligence, you will not be surprised to learn, is greater. But its cognitive intelligence, its IQ, is higher than that of the left, which is contrary to what a lot of people think. And it's much more able to feel its way into an understanding of what it is seeing in the world around it.
But these values of imagination and intuition, I guess one way I think about it is that they give us like broad long-term outcomes. And the less left hemispheric values, reason and logic, seem to give us like immediate and very measurable outcomes. And they seem, I think, the reason, for instance, among the listeners of my podcast, who are often very scientifically minded, there's quite a major divide. They would say, well, we get the machines and the technology from this, what they might consider the whole process of consciousness, but what you would call the left hemispheric. So is that why we currently value the left hemisphere more? Because it gives us the machines, it gives us the technology, and those seem to represent all of our progress at the moment.
Yes, I mean, that takes us a little way, and I don't know how much to go into. But to concentrate on something very clear, the left hemisphere's aim is control and power. That's why it's in service of manipulating the world and getting stuff, grabbing stuff. It controls the right hand with which, for most of us, we do the manipulation. And so its raison d'etre is to increase power. And machines and technology are ways of externalizing this kind of thinking. But what I want to impress on any listener is that, and the full argument is in my books, but that the vision that the left hemisphere brings is woefully deficient. It is extraordinarily lacking in an understanding of context, which changes everything, of implicit meaning, of holes that can't be degraded into parts. It focuses on things that are supposedly precise and builds from there as we make a machine. But actually nothing in the world, except the machines we have made, has this structure. Nothing. Living things certainly don't, and the inanimate world also does not. It is not mechanical. It is not made in a machine-like way. So in order to understand, we need to greatly sophisticate our intelligence and our insight. And this comes from espousing both hemispheres. And I'd just like to comment on the word reason. I make a distinction, which is hard to make in English, between what I call reason and what I call rationalization or rationalizing. And in other languages, there are two different words for this. For example, in German, what I call reason is called Vernunft, and what I'm calling rationalizing is called Verstand. So Verstand or rationalizing is a procedural thing which you do explicitly on a paper, if this, then that, and so on and so forth. Nothing wrong with it. But there is something that's much greater than that, which is the ability to set all this into an overall context. And that's something that comes with leading a wise life. And it's the sort of thing that you would expect from a good judge, that at the end of his or her career, he was able to see the whole picture and understand in the round, to take into account many, many factors in reaching a conclusion. And if you do that, you are less often caught out by reality. If you purely rationalize, you make some very strange steps. And an amusing thing for me is that, I mean, a lot of time in my career, I've spent with patients with schizophrenia, of course. And in schizophrenia, people talk about madness and they say it's the loss of reason. But as has been pointed out by various people, including Minkowski, a very fine Polish-French philosopher and psychiatrist in the first part of the 20th century, but also by others like G.K. Chesterton, the madman is someone who has lost everything but reason, can only rely on reason, and it leads to mad conclusions. So the person who hears a voice, and there's nobody in the room, thinks, well, that's strange, it's not coming from me, so it must, what is there is that's in this room? There's a socket over there in the wall. Somebody has wired into that, is beaming voices into my head. It's kind of logical, but of course it's utterly bonkers. So we need to be careful. Intuitions can, if unguided by reason, lead to falsity, but reason unguided by intuition can surely lead to falsity.
Can I put lay something out for you, and potentially as a mirror of this divide? Do you know Stanley Kubrick's 2001?
Yes, I do. I saw it a very long time ago, and I can't really remember it very well.
Of course. Well, it seems that we've been trying to find kind of a story for how to visualize our reality. We had a great mythos, like the Christian mythos,
yes,
in the Western world. And then we came more and more to science and to reason, maybe these left hemispheric values by going too far in that direction. And then we've been trying to find like a new story to put in its place. And I think science fiction represents an attempt at that story, yeah, in some ways, yeah, that we're going to build space rockets and teleporters and starships, and this will take us off into the galaxy, into the universe, but which is this completely unconscious place, just full of dead matter and maybe some alien civilizations as well. But then in a movie like 2001, Stanley Kubrick, if you remember, he shows you all of the spaceships and the satellites around Earth, but then it's not via those that we actually go out into space. He actually has the astronaut climb inside the mind of HAL, the artificial intelligence, and switch it off, and then we go on this kind of psychedelic journey into outer space. So I'm sorry to test you with a film you only vaguely remember, but does that seem to express some of this divide between the hemispheres as an idea, just in the way that I've laid it out for you?
I think it does, but I caution about the divide, because I make a distinction between division in the sense of complete separation and division in the sense of making a distinction. And there is a distinction between these hemispheres. And one of the myths that I need to stamp on is that the left hemisphere is the hemisphere of science and the right hemisphere is the hemisphere of sort of fantasy. It's certainly not. It is the hemisphere that's much better at imagination. But to go off on a hair, which I won't pursue unless you want me to, imagination is almost the opposite of fantasy. Fantasy takes us away from reality. Imagination enables us to enter into reality. Mm. But yes, I think you're right. One thing to say right away is that there is no conflict between Christianity and science. This is something that has been drummed up by only since the middle of the 19th century by people who, I suppose, looking at it most charitably, they wanted to make sure that there weren't religious constraints on what could be claimed. And that, of course, I would back. Mm. But religion and the myth of Christianity is which is an incredibly, probably the most rich myth that we've ever created, if we created it, is something that speaks of exactly what the best of the left and right hemisphere can bring about. But what happens whenever you have a myth, and if you have a religious myth, is that the left hemisphere wants to codify it. It wants to create a lot of rather odd propositions that you must sign up to, and it wants to structure it in a logical way. And so whole bodies of dogma are created by the left hemisphere, imposing this on religion, which is not the wellspring of religion. The wellspring of religion is something that is carefully responded to by patient attention, by listening to things that you don't expect to hear, understanding the speaking to you of everything around you. And so when, again, you talk about dead matter, and again, how long have you got? But, I mean, you know, I argue in The Matter with Things that, in fact, consciousness is not something that sort of emerged late in the day out of a brain, but is, in fact, a primary element, what's called an ontological primitive in the universe.
There's so much rich stuff in there in relation to this topic. There's something that I've observed, and it's quite widely observed, often among writers of science fiction, which is that the kind of the collective imagination is more and more literal in its interpretation of any story that's given to it.
Absolutely.
So for any half decent writer, if you're writing about space rockets and planets and alien civilizations, there's some level on which you're exploring kind of scientific ideas, but there's also the symbolic and the metaphoric and the mythic in there as well. But it's harder and harder for people to think in that way at the moment.
Absolutely. I mean, one of the most striking things for me is that the left hemisphere doesn't understand anything that is not literal. So it really doesn't understand the point of poetry. Why lie when you could say it clearly? It doesn't understand music. It doesn't understand irony. It doesn't understand sarcasm. It doesn't understand wit or humor. And so what you find is that people take everything incredibly literally and miss the point. So the banishment of humor from public discourse in the recent years has been one of the most grievous losses to humanity that I can imagine. Because in humor, although we think of it as, you know, just an entertaining element, it's actually a very profound element. And it's also got its place in spiritual traditions, above all in Zen, which uses humor to help us see things that are not logically, reductively explicit. So, this is happening everywhere. Now, I might say, if I may, that when I first went to America, I was working at Johns Hopkins in a neuroimaging lab. And I found that in the first few weeks, people kept looking at me, rather puzzled when I'd say something, and they'd go, really? And then I'd go, no, not really, don't mind. Don't worry about it. But I hadn't realized how much of whatever I said was to be read between the lines. It was amusing. It was putting a perspective on something. But they took everything deadly seriously. And this may be an aspect of having a melting pot of cultures where you can't rely on the usual sort of things to do with the way people say things, and so you have to deal only with the explicit. But it's now become what we have to deal with everywhere. Sorry, carry on, please.
I had a very similar experience of doing a long writer's workshop in California. This was over a decade ago now. And I was the only English person there, and I loved everyone on the workshop.
Yes.
But I realized about 2 weeks into it, and I said to one of my friends that I think maybe some of the people in the group are angry with me. And my friend touched me on the knee and said, they don't realize you're being ironic. And I fought back for everything I'd said and thought, oh no, they must think I'm a terrible, terrible person. But so I want to dig into a bit more of what's driving this literalism then. I know this isn't what it is, but is the left hemisphere becoming bigger and dominating us biologically, or is there some kind of feedback mechanism in our culture, or why are we becoming more and more,
yes,
more left hemisphered?
Well, as you rightly say, it's not that the left hemisphere is getting bigger. And in fact, it's of interest that the right hemisphere is slightly bigger and heavier than the left hemisphere in humans. What is happening, I think, is that let me just refer here to one of my favorite philosophers, A.N. Whitehead, who said that a civilization flourishes until it starts to analyze itself. And I think that what happens is that in the way we have mainly lived for thousands and thousands of years is in harmony with nature, in harmony with society, in harmony with the myths, the rituals, the beliefs of our culture, and that these had been ample ways of alerting us to many kinds of truth that was not just a kind of tit-for-tat in the court of law way of debating things, but certain realities could not be encompassed in that way. But they didn't need to be. But what's happened in a largely deracinated culture where people have been torn away from their communities, dragged into the cities, more and more into a world made by machines, reflecting the left hemisphere's kind of a world all around them. When they look out of the window, they see mechanisms, they see hard surfaces on a rigid grid, and they are no longer in touch with what I'm, you know, honored and grateful to be in touch with here, which is being surrounded by nature. And these things teach you, they speak to you. And so I think what's happened is that in this world in which we rely very much on discourse, you have to choose what it is you say. The first thing is that the right hemisphere's story is much more complex than that of the left hemisphere, and therefore requires a lot of effort to articulate, as I know, because I've articulated it at very great length in those two books. And a lot of people write to me and say, I mean, countless people write to me and say, thank goodness you've explained something that I kind of knew at some level, but I just had no way of working it out, expressing it or defending it. And so I think what happens is that you have to make decisions. And the worst thing that can happen to you nowadays is to be said to be inconsistent. In fact, there's a great deal of wisdom in sometimes being inconsistent, because there's usually more than one side to a question. In fact, if only we realized that there's always more than one side to a question, we wouldn't have all the ridiculous self-righteousness, foot-stamping, hysterical fits on the internet when somebody says something that somebody else doesn't agree with. Well, get real, get educated. This is what life is like. And so there's a kind of idiocy and ignorance that has spread across mass culture, which encourages black and white thinking, the loss of all the nuances. And in the process, all the subtle stuff is drowned out by sound bites. And I could say something which, if taken in context, meant almost exactly the opposite of what it would seem to be saying if it was just a soundbite taken out of its context. And so incredible injustice is done to many people by something being taken out of context and whizzed around the world. And then next thing, they find that people are sort of treating them as a non-person.
So we're involved in this process of distancing from nature.
Yes.
and coming more and more into I guess they are machine environments.
Yes.
They've been machines. They are somewhat machine-like.
Yes.
We can go back to a movie like Metropolis, Fritz Lang.
Wonderful.
The whole city is a big machine.
Yes.
And that's 100 years ago.
Yes.
Now, and we've advanced on a lot from there. So can we talk a bit about myth directly, I guess? Firstly, could I ask you kind of, what are your formative mythic influences, like myths maybe that you grew up with or that are important to you?
That's a good one. Well, I certainly didn't have a religious upbringing, not at least until I went to secondary school, where I was fortunate to be introduced to something I thought was beautiful and resonant and deep. So what did I find? I think my father was very literalistic. Bless him. I mean, he was a good man, a very good man, but he didn't have much time for poetry or music or anything like that. He liked facts. And I'm in favor of facts too, a lot of them. And I've defended my point of view with them, but I think there's more to life than that. Robert Graves's The White Goddess, actually, was a book I read in my teens, and I thought it was really, really important. I also read Helen Waddell's The Wandering Scholars, which was about the flourishing of poetry, music, and dance in the late Middle Ages in Europe, and what this meant for the culture. And then I didn't really follow the path. To this day, I haven't read The Hobbit, and I haven't read The Lord of the Rings. And it's not that I don't think, you know, I don't respect Tolkien. I do. It's just rather, as I say, I don't these days have so much time for reading, you know, mythological books. And I remember when I used to go stay with my grandparents, I was encouraged to, and in those days we did as we were told, to go and lie down after lunch, which gave them chance to have a little nap and a bit of a rest. And in my bedroom, beside my table, there was a book, The Myths of Greece. And so I familiarized myself with Greek myths early on. And they were very, they touched me deeply, along with these Celtic myths that I'd heard from Robert Graves. And so these things were very important to me. And then later, you know, as I say, well, not later, but in my teens, I began to become intrigued in exploring further the mythos of Christianity. I mean, a word I use without any implication of this being true or false. Indeed, I think that myths have a kind of truth which is greater than factual truth, which, as I say, was a perception of the ancient Greeks anyway. So these are the things that have really intrigued me. And I also did read the C.S. Lewis Narnia books, partly because I'd read The Last Battle when I was at school. But then when I had children of my own, I read them the whole Narnia 7-part thing. And they were completely rapt by it. And so was I. You know, I was thinking, crikey, this is good stuff. So those are the things that, you know, it more or less obviously have populated my imagination.
I was surprised when you said that you didn't have these things until a little bit later.
No.
In your life.
No.
Because now it seems, I think many people are searching for something that they find in myth, and maybe you did that searching as well. And I think one of the problems with our perception of myth, and especially maybe the Christian mythos, is the idea that's held now that if you went back 300 years, everyone fully believed in Christ or in God or in the elements of the mythos, when in fact I think it's always been a thing that people have searched for and that a few people have found, rather than
I'd go so, you know, far
the actual held belief of everyone.
Well, the holding of fixed belief with certainty is not part of faith. It wouldn't be faith if it was certain. Faith is a matter of fidelity. In fact, that's the root of the word. In other words, it's something that you give your loyalty to because you think it's great and noble, and it will lead you to places of revelation, of illumination, and enlightenment. And I think there's always been this tendency to think that signing up to six impossible things before breakfast is what religion is about, but it is not at all. It's about enriching the way in which you see the entirety of the world, so that once you start to see the world with different eyes, it is far more, it has meaning, it has direction and purpose, it has beauty and truth in it. And these are the things that really seem to me to be the essence of a fulfilling life. Not to have those things is to be set adrift. And I've, you know, this is backed by scientific research, but it's also intuitively obvious that the things that give us a sense of meaning are not invented by us, but are contacted by us. We're able to perceive them. And these are things we perceive with the help of nature, with the help of an intact tradition of a society, and through religions, or at any rate through a spiritual inclination. And these things are all opposed to the machine. There's no place in them for the mechanical, the simply mechanical. The simply mechanical is far too crude, leaves almost everything that's of importance out. And so while it's useful, undeniably, it's only as good as the uses to which it's put. And often we're not the wisest assessors of what's going to happen when we start using it in a certain way. And we're already finding that we've set in motion things that we cannot now easily stop. It's the story of the sorcerer's apprentice, you know, who knew how to utter the spell that would cause the machine to get going, but doesn't know how to stop it. And now there's a lot of people who are warning us about the way in which this is going to impinge on humanity and perhaps take, if I may put it this way, the humanity out of humanity. So I think these things are massively important. And to embrace that mythos of Christianity is not to force yourself to believe anything, but to listen, to open your heart and mind to what is expressed for me most powerfully through the art that it has generated. So through the quite extraordinarily beautiful music, through particularly of the Renaissance, the extraordinarily fine paintings and the very moving poetry. And these things make clear to us things that otherwise we would ignore. So that's my idea in a nutshell, that it's not surprising that we're highly stressed, depressed, anxious, don't know what we're doing, don't know where we're going, because we've chucked all the means towards meaning out. I just want to emphasize again, you know, lots of people say, oh, yes, you need these things, like you make them up. Actually, you're in a padded cell. You can't see anything. It's a horrible business, and the sooner it's over, the better. But let's cheer ourselves up along the way by pretending that there's something out there. No, mate, there is something out there, and we're part of it, by the way. We're, you know, nature is not out there. Nature is in here, and I am in nature. You know, and the divine realm is not something out there or up in the sky. It's something that's in here. And I'm in it, you know, and society is not something other than me. I am in society and society's in me. These are the ways to think.
But when people try to turn to something like the Christian mythos, maybe it's fair to say that what they get first is that left-brained literal interpretation.
Yes.
Of the mythos, which is in its way dogmatic. And they're meeting that with their own left hemisphere,
yes,
interpretation, which is where the arguments come up from.
Yes.
So is there, so I don't want to give this to you, like, because this starts to become a bit like a guru question, I guess, but how do we then reconnect with our right hemisphere? That's a too big a question, I think, but in that, maybe just in that mythic sense, when someone is asking that question, well, the Minotaur doesn't literally exist, or we don't have any historical evidence for a X or Y. Yeah. You know, what is an answer to that, do you think?
Well, that not everything that is very real is pinnable down. It's not capable of being fixed. The left hemisphere wants things that are fixed. and it can fix them in language, and it can fix them by tracing a course in history. But while that is a very useful idea, don't get me wrong, I don't disparage that. I use that all the time. My mind is quite rational, actually. But it also realizes, using reason, that reason is not everything. And Pascal himself said, reason is feeble indeed if it cannot explain that reason is not everything. And of course, in for people who like scientific and mathematical proofs, Gödel's theorem actually proves that there are things that are certainly true within a certain framework, but cannot be proved within that frame. So I think one needs to free oneself from the idea that one builds up a picture of reality from little nuggets that one puts together. Well, I've got a fact there and a fact there. I put them together. Gosh, they don't seem to mean anything. Well, no, first of all, you've taken them out of context. They only mean something in the context that they're in. And so we need that business of bringing together. But it doesn't start from the bits. It starts from the fact that things already cohere and that our mind wants to break them up. So one has to think in broader patterns over greater distances in time and in space. So we are connected with others across time and space. We are as connected with our ancestors as we are with our descendants. And we have loyalties to both and duties to both. And we're also connected to people all around the world, as we more and more perceive through the damage that has been done by industrialization. And so I think the first thing is to perceive the world differently. Often in a religion, people will say, and they're right, to be, a Christian is not to believe the following things and never doubt them, but it is to see with new eyes, to feel with a new heart. There is a medieval prayer which I think is very important, God be in my head. And it's very short, it's only a few lines. You know, God be in my head and in my understanding, God be in my eyes and in my looking, God be in my mouth and in my speaking, God be in my heart and in my thinking, God be at mine end and at my departing. And that very neat and short poem is very much about what I was talking about, internalizing something that is bigger than you. And so the first thing is to change the cast of mind. And people might say, well, how do I do that without working from step to step? But that, again, is the left hemisphere. And this is actually not the way things work. Many things come as a moment of insight, as an aha moment, a rejigging of a shape, of a form, so that you see it anew. And boringly, as a psychiatrist, a lot of work that I have done is helping people to see for themselves what it is they need to do. And that, you know, if you make the mistake, as when I was wet behind the ears and hadn't a lot of experience in psychiatry, I used to do, which was to tell people what they needed to do. It wasn't that I was wrong. I was right. But the thing is, it's no good telling people until they see it for themselves. And what's more, what they will see is greater than anything I can tell them and more appropriate to them. So that's what I'd say. I mean, of course, I can become banal and say there are things to do, like practice mindfulness, which I think is very important. Practice being compassionate and grateful. These are simple things. And listen more to music and attend to it. Don't just, you know, have it on in the background and not pay attention to it. So, and to read myths and re-engage really with a mythology. And the best mythologies are religious mythologies, in my view. I mean, they're the accumulation of wisdom of so many people over so long. The idea that little me can, in my lifetime, with the little bit that I know, improve on that is hubris, isn't it? Isn't that just an extraordinary act of arrogance? So it's not to say that, you know, traditions aren't changing. They're changing all the time. They flow. But the only way in which we can make things go in the direction that we think is better is by engaging with that tradition. It's like a plant that you want to go somewhere. You don't cut it off from its stem and roots and stick it on the wall. You train it there. And that's what a tradition is like.
That's very cool. I think maybe I can push on that. a bit. So I think for people today, there is a great difficulty engaging with these religious traditions, which I would say are kind of the great mythoses, perhaps,
mythoi.
of our civilization.
Yes.
Yeah, mythoi.
Yes.
Yeah. So I think we're engaging instead with what we might call a synthetic mythos. And two of the great figures in that happening, one is Joseph Campbell.
Yes.
And his hero's journey, or his monomyth.
Yeah.
So he
yes.
I would say it's kind of like a synthesizing. He takes all of this pattern from great mythic traditions, especially the Christian tradition.
Yes.
And presents it in a kind of as a pattern.
Yes.
Which is then picked up by storytellers, and famously Star Wars, but hundreds of other movies. And these movies seem to be consistently very powerful.
Yes.
For people. They have a real effect.
Yes.
And then Campbell's ideas are really coming from Carl
exactly.
Jung, and his ideas about archetypes and so on. So could you comment perhaps a bit on the idea of could a synthetic mythos have value in that way? And also about perhaps a relationship between Jung and your own thinking on the hemispheres and meaning and myth.
Yes, there is a very strong link between my thinking and Jung, and it really wasn't from reading Jung that I generated what I think. It worked the other way, that I worked from the neuroscience to see what the picture was, and it wasn't always the one that people would anticipate. And yet I found constantly resonances with Jung's work, and with Hillman, you know, James Hillman, who was a disciple, if you like, of Jung. So yes, no, I agree with this. What I found is that mythoi from all around the world have similar core perceptions. At the beginning of part three of The Matter with Things, which is the section on ontology or metaphysics, whatever you like to call it, and I quote at some length a myth of the Onondaga people, who are Iroquois, which I think is staggering. I mean, when I first read it, I could not believe it. It was absolutely what I was seeing in the hemispheres. Mm. It's a story of two brothers, one of which is more insightful and better motivated than the other, but they both have divine power. And what needs to happen is that the one that is more fallible, more and more arrogant and more resentful, this other brother, is kept, if you like, under the aegis of the wise brother. But they shouldn't get too close together, because otherwise what the right hemisphere, the mm-hmm. master, the better brother sees, would be vitiated by what the left hemisphere contributes. And so that was a staggering one. But, you know, people don't have to espouse Christianity. I happen to think it's the richest of all the mythologies. But there's so much in Vedanta. There's so much in Taoism. I'm a Taoist. And there's no contradiction between being a Taoist and being, in my case, a very odd and probably not very good Christian. But at least these are other ways of these are other ways of thinking. That it's so rich that to neglect them is to deprive yourself of all the things that to me seem to give life its richness. So I hope people will rediscover them. And I think, although you say people are very resistant to this, I think they're resistant to the bad stuff, and particularly when they look at religions that are fundamentalist and violent and hateful. That has nothing to do with religion. Mm. Nothing. So, I mean, that's just a perversion of religion. It's a horrible excrescence from a religion. But they are searching for myth, but not just the sort of myth that somebody made up yesterday, really, but one that seems to reflect a deep insight into the nature of the cosmos. And sometimes this can be done in less mythical terms. I mean, I hope that what I have, if you like, I certainly don't want to go on record as saying that I think the hemisphere differences is a myth, except in the sense that myths can be profoundly true in a logical way as well. But it is, if you like, a helpful myth that enables people to see why certain things go together, you know. Why, for example, would an attention to detail, a failure to understand implicit meaning, and a kind of insane optimism go together. I mean, they don't sound like they should. But in fact, if you know about hemisphere differences, you can see exactly why they do. And then you can start seeing it in... I just put those three randomly together, because after all, there are so many differences, you can find many intersections. But all I'm really saying is that the old vision of the right and left was just so wrong, and we need to really pay attention critically to what the real differences are if we're to know ourselves. And you know, the great injunction of the ancient Greek world was know thyself. It's very simple, two words, but so profound.
I think my before encountering your ideas, and they helped me to understand this much more clearly, my way into some of this was through attempting to be creative, trying to write for me. Quite young, actually, I started teaching writing. And one of the groups of people I would work with were people who were very intelligent, usually professionals, now retired professionals. So they had a very highly trained intellect, and they were trying to crack this nut of being creative. And I came up with my own myth about it, which I would use with people, which is that the part of you that wants to be creative is like a crazy old hippie that has huge ideas about, often about myths, actually. But in order to express it, you have to get the crazy old hippie to work with a kind of uptight middle manager who actually has the writing skills that are needed to do the writing. And you have to somehow get these two characters into a room together and get them working together, which I think for me is something like the left and right hemispheres in their character. But I feel that for a lot of people, this is their way into this is about this creative challenge. Like, you try and write, but there's this inner editor who's always there criticizing everything that you write, so you never you never finish anything.
Well, just as an aside, that's been a big problem in my life. I have a very strong inner critic. But I think the only thing I'd have to do here is to dissociate myself from the idea that the right hemisphere is a crazy old hippie. The right hemisphere is the fount of wisdom, okay. Really. And is also very down to earth, by the way, unlike many hippies. It is actually the one that is more in touch with reality and better grounded than the left, which goes off on fantasies. But what I would add to your picture is that when people want to be creative, their wanting to be creative is something to be slightly wary of, because it's one of those things that can't be wanted in a left hemisphere way. So what do? If I follow the following steps, and that is not going to work any more than I want to believe it, you know, really work. I mean, you can try, it's true. But in a way, you have to open yourself up to something that you don't yet know what it is. And in order to do that, you have to still the part of your mind that is striving to achieve, this part of your mind that says, I know what it is, I know what I need. Because every time we say, I know, we close down again on the familiar that we're trying to get away from. And so a lot of time in creation passes in what appears to be unfruitful openness to things without any conclusions being drawn. But it's only in that wise silence of not saying and not doing that things will begin to reveal themselves to us. Steiner has written very well, George Steiner, on this idea of the sort of attentive mind that is hearing something. It's not quite clear yet, but it's leaning into it. And that is a very good model, which he sees actually imaged in the four paintings of the Annunciation by Fra Angelico, in which the Virgin is sort of listening to the angel, and the angel is sort of, as it were, attending to the Virgin. Anyway,
yeah, and just just sitting with some of that for a moment. When you said about your own inner critic,
yes,
there, have you, do you feel that in the writing of non-fiction, of these two books, that you have silenced the critic to some extent?
I have theories when I can. The critic is usually most vocal when I'm trying to get started, which is a sort of catch 22. And in fact, I only was able to write The Master and His Hemisphere by pretending to myself, and I really did believe that's what I was doing. I said, look, okay. I wrote all the main concepts, about 70 of them, on little lozenges of paper, and I laid them all out on the floor in the living room and moved them about to see where they went and see if I could find a diagram. But I really couldn't. So I said to myself, write no more than 25 pages, a skeleton of where you want to be going in this book. And I headed it up, as you can, of course, in Word, with a header that said Draft Outline of the Master and His Hemisphere. And it finally reached about 1,300 pages of text. And I printed it off and gave it to a friend of mine who I call my unofficial editor because he's so insightful. And he had a shop. I gave it to him in a shopping bag, and he looked in and he saw the title, and he said, "Some outline." And indeed, it was. But that was the way in which I sort of fooled myself into writing it. But another thing is that I feel that when I'm writing well, stuff comes that from that place which is not entirely forced or intended. Stuff asks me to be written. And I've sometimes thought, when I look at The Master's Hemisphere, and even more when I look at The Matter with Things, which, as you know, is an even greater task in terms of the amount of scholarship and science in it, I sort of look at it and think, but how did you write that? I mean, you're a lazy person. How could you have written it? So I come to the conclusion that, you know, the mice wrote it in the night. You know, the tailor of Gloucester came down in the morning, not having enough cloth for the waistcoat he had to deliver in the morning, and suddenly found the mice had made it. I feel not like that. You see, the thing is that very little of what goes on is conscious. We have this idea that there are two tanks. There's a sort of nice, big, clear tank of consciousness, and underneath is a slightly murky, muddy region, which has a sort of, perhaps a sort of flip column through which you can pass from one to the other. But most of what goes on is in the consciousness. This is absolutely not true. I mean, I used to say that 95% of all our mental activity is unconscious, but a paper with rather amusing precision that I quote in the book says that 99.44% of all mental activity is not conscious. In other words, you don't have to buy the precision to get the point that almost everything we do, and not just the sort of lesser stuff, goes on unconsciously. So we solve difficult problems in maths, in our life. We project how to deal with the future, to make decisions, to like things, to fall in love, to not. All these things are going on under the radar, and they're not unintelligent for that. They're using our full intelligence.
And you found a very... For a work of very based on a lot of very rigorous research, you found a very potent myth to communicate.
Yes,
in the master and his hemisphere, yes. Which I think is why it has communicated, because this seems to be a very important part of communicating complex ideas to people.
Yes,
I think, for instance, that like Einsteinian relativity is completely incomprehensible to most people, but the idea that you go to space and you come back and it's the future because of relativity, that is the myth that people can actually cling on to, or the trains in relation to each other.
Yes,
and what you're describing is quite a consistent story of myth makers.
Yes,
that this comes from somewhere beyond us, from artists and creators and scientists as well. But anyone who reaches that real insight, it seems to come from beyond us. Is that beyond the right hemisphere, or is that simplifying too much?
I think that could be simplifying too much. The thing is, we don't know really the depth of our knowledge, because if we did, we'd be conscious of it. But I think that in our unconscious, we are making sense of, clocking and understanding intuitively something about the way our mind and therefore our brain works. And for me, the best demonstration of this is this Onondaga legend, which is completely amazing. It's so accurate about how the brain actually works. And it comes from an era before there were any brain imaging studies. So I think that's the way I'd put it. The difficulty with the myth is that, you know, people who are very, if you like, narrow in their thinking, think that, well, if he's created a thing that's a myth, it must be wrong. He's not a real scientist. Well, this is rather a shame because, you know, I've really sweated blood over the science. And I defy anyone to show me exactly why I've got this wrong. And nobody ever has. In fact, there's a very interesting phenomenon, which is something like this. Scientists say, well, I love the neuroscience and you know, no quarrel with that. It's very interesting and revealing. But then you go on and apply it to life, you know, and I'm not with you there. And then there are other people who say, well, I don't know about the neuroscience and so on, but what you see in the evolution of Western culture is so right, you know, just it cries out. So you've got these two people, each of them sort of saying, yes, this bit's fine, this bit, they don't want a corpus callosum to put them together. But that's what I hope I have provided, because they do need to be seen together. And my editor at Yale for the Master in Chemistry, I sort of said, you know, I think there are two books here. We could make two books out of this. And she very wisely said, yeah, but the trouble is that the scientists would read one and the humanities people would read the other, and never the twain should meet. And so I'm extremely glad that she insisted they should all be part of one book.
Can I ask you about the idea of the machine?
Absolutely.
Again, because this is very powerful in science fiction. We have from Frankenstein,
exactly.
So Mary Shelley's Frankenstein, written in the Gothic tradition, but it's often recognized as the first science fiction novel.
Yes.
You, of course, have a scientist at the heart of it. But then this idea that you can put together a body from spare parts, that if we've given up the idea of humans as some kind of divine entity, perhaps with a soul, what do we say they are? So we start to say that we're machines. And Shelley reflects on that and reflects on the kind of the horror of that possibility. A very famous science fiction movie like The Matrix, where we're literally lost in machines that control every part of our life. And this is something I talk with about my podcast listeners, because I'd say about 70% of the science fiction community, and I poll them on this, if I ask them, would say, yes, I am a machine. And they might add to that I am a biological machine. Mm-hmm. So this seems to be the mythos of our time. This is how we understand ourselves now, as a machine. And I know that you can see through that or pass that for us. And I'd like you maybe to talk to my listeners who think that they are machines about how to have a larger picture of ourselves than that.
Well, in chapter 12 of The Matter with Things, a chapter called The Science of Life, a case of left hemisphere capture, what I'm arguing there is that organisms are wholes that are not decomposable into their parts and are not understood if viewed as machines. And that's not anything I say without serious scientific evidence. And there are a number of talks I've now done, perhaps half a dozen, with Michael Levin, who is a distinguished professor at Tufts and a microbiologist and geneticist and evolutionary biologist, about this. And I think that more and more I see people realizing that the old story that was told, that we were all, you know, this sort of, and poor old Dawkins, but this idea that somehow, you know, we're lumbering robots controlled by our genes for their benefit. That was a myth that was simply mythical in the pejorative sense, and that we're not machines. And we completely miss many things and can't explain many things if we think of ourselves as such. I think I give at least 8 ways in which we differ from machines and look over the evidence in some detail. So I recommend people to read it if they're interested. But I think there's a big problem here, which is more of a philosophical nature, that we don't understand the relationship between parts and a whole. And what I think is that parts are an invention. So what there are is wholes. In other words, not mechanical constructions, but non-divisible, although they have distinguishable parts, but non-divisible wholes that can't be reduced to their parts. And there was a great mathematician and philosopher called Robert Rosen, who wrote a book called Life Itself, and a more approachable book called Essays on Life Itself, in which he argues that whatever exists is largely better understood by assimilating it to the model of an organism than that of a machine, even the inanimate world. And he leads to the conclusion that actually inanimacy is something that doesn't really exist, but would be the asymptotically approached reality if one pushed the mechanical idea far enough, but it doesn't actually exist anywhere. And that when one starts realizing that what one's dealing with is organic wholes, one understands their behavior and the way in which we can understand them. We understand them much better. So all that exists is wholes, and what we see as parts are wholes at another level. And so there are, just, in a sense, a nesting of wholes in the cosmos. And different wholes are appropriate at different levels of magnification, if you like to talk in those terms. So that's some of what I'd say. But I could, you know, quote some fascinating things that suggest that we're not a whole. I mean, Barbara McClintock, who won a Nobel Prize for her work in microbiology, was able to show that microorganisms, bacteria and single cells were able to respond in an imaginative way to a crisis that they were never programmed to tackle and had never experienced before. But they came up with a solution nonetheless. And that requires a certain kind of intelligence. Whatever you like to say, it might not be intelligence like yours or mine, but it's some kind of an intelligence. And there are many other instances throughout the natural world, plants that make decisions that they simply can't possibly have been prepared for in strange situations set up in the laboratory. I probably haven't got time to explain them here, but they are gripping and amazing. So we know that all that lives, and probably all the things that we don't think live, behave in ways that we haven't completely fathomed. And as you go further and further into the ultra-microscopic world of particle physics and so on, you realize that once again, the idea of a mechanism doesn't work. So the way I look at it is the idea of a mechanism is a kind of shoddy model that works okay for practical purposes in the middle of something, but it doesn't work at all when you go small or go big, and it doesn't work at all when you go in rather than out. So as I sometimes say, if I were building a garage, I don't need to take into account the curvature of the world, but that doesn't mean the world is flat. The world is curved, and it's spherical, and that's really important to know. But for certain purposes, one can ignore reality, and the left hemisphere's model is not real. It's a model, exactly that, and a machine is simply a model. It's a way in which we have modeled things in order to be able to manipulate the world better, and for those purposes, they work. But our mistake is to think that because we've made something that worked, we understand the things of which it is only a remote cousin, or not even that, because it doesn't belong to the same family at all.
Could we almost argue then that there aren't any machines? A machine is when we impose this this map onto something which is actually a set of holes, and we see it as a machine because we're going to use it for a certain purpose there.
Yes, all the ways in which we understand things are models, and we improve the model or we yeah. don't. And I think the model of the machine, yes, it works very well every day for making stuff to help us manipulate. But it's not truthful. It's just a model, not a very good one, not a very sophisticated one. But, yeah, it's fine. And the proof of the pudding is that it has made us powerful, alas, without improving our wisdom. And I would say we're probably the least wise people that have ever inhabited the Earth, and yet we're also the most powerful. This is a dangerous combination.
And we tell this story in myth over and over again that our machines are very powerful, but they're not wise, they're unable to wield meaningful to create meaningful things in the world. Yeah. They will strip meaning out of everything. Yeah. But it seems very. I just want to push on it a little bit further. It seems very, very, very sad that so many people see ourselves. So certainly, probably up until my mid-20s, I would have agreed with that assertion that I am a machine. Yeah. And I feel sad about that in retrospect for what I may have thought about myself. And I think it was also accompanied with a lot of other thoughts. Yeah. You know, a certain despair. If the world is just a big machine, where is the meaning in any of this for me?
Well, yes, and you referred to images coming from the early 20th century, and one that you probably know is The Machine Stops, a short story by E.M. Forster, which is amazing. He saw already in 1912, whenever he wrote it, that we were going to be ending up basically living in a machine, depending on it and not really understanding what lay outside it. So it is a worry. But, you know, can a machine bleed, to quote Merchant of Venice? Can a machine sorrow? Can it fall in love? Can it change its mind? Can it truly imagine? In what way is a machine like us? All that we do in AI is to project outwards a bloodless, abstracted way of thinking, turning something that is something we should be trying to get beyond, not enlarge. And it is the means whereby the left hemisphere's thinking is pushed outwards into the world. You see, because the left hemisphere loves a theory, it prefers anything that fits with the theory and doesn't see anything that doesn't fit with its theory. So once you've decided that people are machines, for example, just to take an example, then you don't see all the evidence of things that don't fit with that. Because the left hemisphere wants consistency with its model. The right hemisphere is what V.S. Ramachandran, a very great neuroscientist, called the devil's advocate. In other words, it says, yeah, but hang on, it might not be like that. Now, that's a really important element to have in one's armory. And the right hemisphere's way of approaching things is, okay, you say this in theory. Let's now test it against reality. Now, that's great, but the difficulty is that the left hemisphere has colonized external reality. So for many people, when they look outwards into the world, they see a screen, they see a machine, they see all around them, they see a bringing into being of this mechanical utilitarian world, which is the left hemisphere's world. And in recent years, it has pushed forward in two very damaging ways. One is a colossal growth, like a cancer, of administration. So that now all the institutions that look after us and look after our future, the universities, the schools, the hospitals are top-heavy with departments of management that try to tell teachers and doctors and lecturers what they should say and what they should do and who they should hire. And this is a very bad state of affairs. It's an expression outwards of left hemisphere procedural thinking, and the other is AI. And now so much of time is wasted for all of us, I mean, by machines. So something that 10 years ago would have taken a five-minute phone call to somebody in the office who said, yeah, I see what's going on, don't worry, I can sort that. But now I spend literally half a day on the internet, and instead of being able to speak to somebody, it says, you know, we can help you. Our frequently asked questions. But the frequently asked questions are never the ones I'm really asking, because they're too generic, and I've got a difficult problem here. And, you know, there are boxes you have to tick and things you have to go through to get there. And I can't, because nothing is truthful in response to them. So this is a huge waste of time. I mean, you might, I don't know if I've got time, just very briefly to refer to an amusing episode in recent history when I gave a lecture for Oxford University, and much to my amazement was paid for it. I thought it was delightful. It was rather handsomely paid for it. And in the old days, what would have happened is that the finance department called the University Chest would have sent me a cheque in the post and I'd have cashed it. But no, now lots of things have to be done through a platform online. And not only one, but a couple of platforms, and you can only graduate to the second one once you've done the first. And they said, don't worry, we've got someone who will guide you through this. 3 months into this process, not having got onto the second platform, the person moved on to another job, but said, don't worry, there's somebody else is coming. 6 months into this process, this other person and I had not been able to solve the problem. And eventually I thought, what the hell is going on here? Because it asked me to tick a box, and there were 77 boxes representing what I could have provided as a service to the university. And I could have provided window cleaning, I could have provided catering, but there wasn't one for giving a lecture, which seems to me a rather fundamental part of the life of a university. So I rang up and amazingly got a person, that won't happen in a few years' time. And I said, this is hopeless. And he said, oh, tell me about it. It's the bane of our lives. It's ridiculous. It doesn't correspond with reality. It gives us so much extra work. Well, this is, of course, what's happening for all of us. And so she said, I said, well, what do I do? Because I'm completely stuck. I can't move on. She said, just tick any box and we'll pay you. So I ticked window cleaning. And you know, they paid me, which is lovely. And I justified it to myself by saying, you know, metaphysically, I was cleaning their windows.
Well, they're the same thing, I guess, aren't they? The administration, the bureaucracy, and the
exactly.
AI. Because the only thing actually the AI will be able to do is perpetuate bureaucracy.
Perpetuate what is already underway, yeah.
Yeah. And what you said in there to pluck this out is that what the left hemisphere theorizes or models is less and less like reality.
Yes.
And more like a machine.
Yes.
And what we are doing is actually going further and further from a reality that we can't touch anymore, because we're in the mentality of the machine. We built the machines around us, and the machine is all of this idea about the world that the left hemisphere prefers to reality.
That's exactly right. And what's interesting is that and I've come to see the importance of this more and more, is that the left hemisphere doesn't really recognize anything it itself has not made. So the right hemisphere is interested in what actually exists, but the left hemisphere is interested in things that conform to the model of things it has made. And so unless it has already got this idea, because remember, it likes the familiar, the things that fit, it doesn't like anything that disturbs that. Anything that isn't made by it becomes target. And I believe that at the moment we see the war being waged on nature and on life by the left hemisphere world. And that things that don't fit with the narrative are being ignored, ostracized, dismissed, destroyed. And more and more of what we will get is the, quote, wisdom of some ChatGPT with steroids on steroids, which basically does a survey of the internet and comes up with stuff which has already been put there largely by people who've been consulting ChatGPT and no doubt its descendants in due course. So what we're getting is a self-referential loop that it will be impossible eventually to break out of, because anything other than that will be called untrue or pseudoscience or whatever. We desperately need to get back to truth, and in Oxford on the 9th of February, I'm giving a talk to the university on truth and why the university is becoming less and less relevant because it is turning away from the pursuit of truth.
Yeah, well, Iain, I've had you for about an hour and 20 minutes of recording. I'd love to carry on for a little bit longer, as long as you're happy to
do that. Yes, I am, yes. Okay. Yeah.
Okay, wonderful. Let me go a bit, make a speculation here then, which I've had in response to your thinking quite a few times, that on the direction of myth, and so we were talking about truth there, a truth and reality. Mm. Basically, so I'll put it on the table just as a statement. We've said that as well. You made the point that myths tend to express these related worldviews or ideas. There's a certain consistency across all of our mythoi. One, I think, is like the presence of some kind of higher being or a higher consciousness, be it like gods or angels or devas in Hindu mythology. Another we might point to is maybe a kind of other realmness, which we speculate on in mythology. So I want to ask, is it possible that the way that the right hemisphere sees the world is what it shows us then in the myths? That it tells us is this mythic reality that we've pushed so far away closer to a truth about our reality?
I would certainly say that. It would be illogical for us to suppose that we knew everything or could understand everything. I mean, if a mouse could think and speak as we do, it would say, well, you know, there's nothing beyond what I know, but we know there is. And there may be creatures in future or elsewhere that know more than we do. But that knowledge exists, whether we know it or not, if you like. There is something there beyond what we can grasp. It would be an extraordinary act of blind arrogance, really, to suggest, no, we know it all. We understand it all. And there are deep, both intuitions and elements of experience that suggest that there is more to this cosmos than we know the full story of. It's not a very extravagant claim, actually. And the right hemisphere is able to put us in touch with that better than the left, because the left only understands, as I say, what it's grasped as things it could make or has made. So its world is populated by its own conceptions, but the trouble is that its own conceptions are too narrow. And the way to break out of this is by engaging the not fanciful right hemisphere, but the imaginative right hemisphere, which is able to see into things, deep into them, in a way that the left hemisphere cannot. So I do believe that, yes. And I think the notion that there is a cosmos out there and greater than us is a great relief in a way, because you then can begin to open up and feel that it is not your job somehow to sort it all out but it is your job, and this is a serious duty, to respond to it, to at least respond to it. And I believe truth is a relationship. Truth is an encounter. It's not stuff just out there, and it's not just stuff I made up, but it's what comes about through my encounter with everything else, and obviously every other person's encounter with everything else. Now, that doesn't mean that we just make it up. It means that there is a reality that it behoves us to be true to, in the way that we use the word true in a belief, you know, I'd be true to somebody that I'm loyal to. And when you live in that truth and in that loyalty, that whatever it is then begins to grow and become part of you, and you become part of it. So it is a generative encounter in which both parties are untouched. And so what we need to get away from is the idea that there is a truth, as it were, in a box somewhere, and we take a path towards it, and we open the box, and we've got it. It is, in fact, a journey. It will always be a journey, mm-hmm. because it's one that can never be fully completed. But the fact that it can never be fully completed is not a problem, because the value of it is in honorably, truthfully, loyally, magnanimously, generously, kindly following that path, bearing in mind the higher values, not just those that are useful to us, but things like goodness, beauty, and truth. So, I mean, this is the vision that I have. I can't help people for whom it means nothing, but to me, it means a very great deal. And it also means that, in a way, your life is not pointless or purposeless. No, your purpose and point is to help grow the good things that are in the cosmos. It's beauty, not to bring ugliness, not to bring destruction, but to bring more connection, more kindness and tolerance, more beauty, more goodness into the world. I mean, I'm sorry if I sound preachy, but hell, I mean, these are important messages. And, I'm not really a paid-up member of any religion, but that shouldn't stop me from seeing these things.
I think that mythos precedes religion.
Yes.
Religion maybe is that kind of formalized dogmatic thing, but mythos is trying to show us.
I agree.
Yeah.
But also it takes it further. Yeah. So it's very difficult to engage simply with the mythos without all the other things that religion begins. I mean, the word means a binding, and it means the coming together of minds who can pursue things, who can share things, who can feel a relationship. And this is very important for human flourishing. So, and also very beautiful, as I was saying, works of art and rituals, and indeed myths, that have been generated by religion. So it's a two-way flow. When religion becomes too sclerotic, then it's a problem, I agree. But it also does a sort of two-way dance with our mythical sense in helping us to guide that, because we might have a myth of, I mean, anything really, in a way. And that could be unfortunate, because, most people can see the falsity of certain kinds of myths. For example, the myth that was perpetuated throughout most of the 20th century by the Soviet Union or by Mao. These were mythologies. They were profoundly destructive, horribly cruel, and attacked everything good and beautiful. So these are not good myths. So we need to have, in a way, a bit of a touchstone. And that can be an internal touchstone, but it can also benefit from, after all, the condensate of knowledge of people from days gone by who are not stupid because they weren't us or didn't know things we know. There's lots of things they knew that we have forgotten.
That I want to push a little bit more. I want to be the voice of some of my podcast listeners for a second. They kind of willingly listen to me talking about myth, but they don't really think science fiction is myth, and they think myth is just made up. So now I've just put the idea on the table for them that no, actually, myth is a bit more like reality than our logos. The mythos is at least necessary, and I think they would at this point actually have some anger about it, because they had this perception of myth as lie, and they don't want a lie asserted as real. So I just channeled them to that length there. So what more could we say to them?
Well, the first thing is to be aware when you're finding something makes you angry. I don't mean just in the way that a psychiatrist would say that's probably showing you a conflict in you that you're not recognizing. But I mean that anger is absolutely the main mode of operation of the left hemisphere. It's always angry. And it's always right, by the way. It always knows what the truth is. thinks it does. But of course, you know from my work that actually it's often frankly deluded, completely deluded. But it's emphatic that what it thinks it knows is the only story. And thinking you know the only story is also, I would say, a bit of an alarm bell. Hey, are you really sure about that? What about listening to a few other people and seeing if that perhaps rings a bell? The other thing I'd say is that, what about poetry? Poetry takes us to places that are not just literal scientific facts. But are you prepared to say that poetry is lies? If so, I can't really help you. I'm just interested to know. Because if you think that, you're going to miss out on an enormous amount of experience that is profoundly, it speaks to us as embodying truths, truths that are much harder to express in the language one might use for a dishwasher instruction manual. And so what are we really saying? It was only with Locke in the 18th century that people started to talk about myths and poetry and so on as lies. And one has to be very careful about that, because there are things that can be believed as unshakably true because we've proved them according to what we know, which we now know are not true. So until Rutherford, we thought that the universe really obeyed Newtonian mechanics. But there's ample evidence over the last 100 years that this is simply not the case. And we're now seeing, as I say, in biology, that there's evidence that there are, whatever you like to call them, form fields or whatever, that guide the development of an organism that are nowhere to be found in the genome. We believed it was all in the genome. Then we sequenced the genome, and we found there wasn't, not only was there wasn't enough information, but there was hardly any. And it was so small, the amount of information. It was many orders of magnitude, too little to express what it is that organisms can do. So we're now opening our minds again and thinking, well, maybe there's something else going on here. When you think about that, you come to different conclusions. And I think it's worth mentioning that almost all the physicists of the 20th century, the great ones who one thinks of as having developed quantum mechanics, people like Niels Bohr, Max Planck, Heisenberg, Schrödinger, and so on. I don't need to go through the panoply, but practically all of them had a great deal of time for religious myths. And in fact, there is, I quote in the book, evidence about the beliefs of Nobel Prize winners. The Nobel Prize has been awarded since 1900. So we have evidence over the last 120 years of the religious beliefs of people who won Nobel Prizes. Are scientists less religious than the people who are at the top of their game in the humanities? No. In the humanities, the rate of people who at some point in their life have been disbelievers in the divine is about 35%. It's still not a majority, but it's pretty large. And as you go down into the sciences, it's something like it's something like 8 or 9% for biology, about 7% for chemistry, and it's 4.7% for physicists. They are the most religious people, and it's also the hardest science, frankly. So I just ask all these people who just know they're right and get very angry when someone says something they don't agree with to, you know, calm down, take a deep breath, consider that you might not know everything, that the things you believe are right might only temporarily seem to be right, and are just a stepping stone on reaching greater truth, greater wisdom. That's all I can say. And you know, the great thing as a psychiatrist is that you know there are people you can't help. And so you stop banging your head against, you know, I'm never going to win this person over. So you stop worrying about it. There are always going to be people who don't see what it is you're talking about. Fine. Everybody has to sit with the truth as they know and the consequences of that. So good luck, you know, if you're one of the angry young men or angry old men. There we are.
Well, I think something we've lost in our teaching, because we're not allowed to offend students. Is that you can't really teach anything without pushing people to the point of anger, because it's part of our development. Can I put one more big question on the table for you before we wrap up, which is the future? So obviously the future is a big part of science fiction, and I think that's because the future has become very important to us. We don't have another world to think about, so we think about the future of this world. And you mentioned actually Stalin and Mao, I think, just now. So that was one kind of utopian vision of the future, maybe a future with no injustice, assuming we give them the credit that they actually believed what they were saying. So we have that utopian future, but the most powerful future seems to be progress. The future will have progressed, primarily technologically will have better technology. But none of these seem to be particularly compelling futures for us at the moment. We think more actually about Armageddon and dystopia and the destruction of the world, maybe via climate change. So I wonder if you have thoughts on the future, and maybe a big question about maybe what might a more hemispherically balanced future look like? What might a more right hemisphere future look like, perhaps?
Well, of course, talking of myths, the myth of progress is a very singular idea. I mean, it was never espoused before by any other culture, but it's become ours since the Enlightenment, which was a very valuable but also hubristic movement that believed that it knew everything and understood everything, and that the future would be ever more wonderful. I read a wonderful German haiku the other day, which basically translated goes, "In the past it was good, then everything became much better. If only it were good again." Anyway, I think predicting the future is famously a mug's game, so I don't know. But I think it's very wise of us to think about the consequences of our actions. And I take that the cautionary principle has a great deal in it, and that there are certain steps you can take that will be extremely hard to reverse. And we've talked a bit about that already, how a cage that's made out of self-referring loops will be very difficult to break out of. So I do worry about that, and I think it's the way we're going. And it's certainly the case that the greatest crimes in the history of humanity, in terms of their scope and severity, have been conducted by people who thought they knew how to make a better world. So we have Lenin and Stalin and Mao and Pol Pot and so on. People who are a little bit more humble and want to work with people to make them, to change their understanding of other people, to be more tolerant of other people, not less tolerant of them, would be important. So I think what I would say is there's a more hemisphere balanced future would be a beautiful place to live. It would be one where, yes, science made progress, but it wasn't trammeled by, as we now know, that science is being trammeled by a form of political correctness and wokeness. There are certain things that are true, but are known to be true, but can't be said and are dismissed, and other things that, because they promote the received narrative, are not good science, but are nonetheless published. So, recent piece of research shows that scientists, the majority, nearly all, in fact, in the words of the piece of research, scientists consulted in the US, said that they, to some extent, self-censored what it was they said or thought or investigated. So it would be a world that was more in touch with truth, but also a kinder one. Because, you know, for all that we're trying to achieve this wonderfully balanced and lovely world, I've noticed during my lifetime a great loss of joy and peacefulness. You know, in the world I grew up, we no more thought of, you know, the things that trouble us now as huge problems. Maybe we should have done, but in fact, there was more understanding between the sexes. There was probably less anxiety between and fear between the races. And I know that's a difficult area to go into because there are all kinds of points of view, and I respect that it's complicated. But I think it's also worth considering that we haven't necessarily made it all better. In fact, what we've done, whatever we have done, is produce a world which is racked with mental illness and in which people feel adrift and don't know what to say or what to believe. So I think in that world, we would have returned to a sense of purpose, which was anchored around the great values of goodness, beauty, and truth, and a sense of the sacred. And we would begin to work together rather than work against one another, not feeding conflict and adversity and I'm right, you're wrong, and I need power, and you must have less. But instead, a sort of seeing that we can work together. This is so elementary that it's been part of all the people who have really helped humanity forward in the last, you know, in the 20th century, of Mahatma Gandhi and indeed of Martin Luther King, and Nelson Mandela. I mean, it was that we need to work together to cooperate, because if we don't, we'll die. I mean, there's no question about it. And, you know, interestingly, the story of evolution is not one of constant opposition and aggression. That comes into it. It's a very important part of the picture. But actually, the species that have been most successful have been those who learnt to cooperate. So cooperation is a big part of becoming whatever we are. And I would say that if we could adopt a little more humility about what we know, faced with an insight into actually how little we understand, if we could rediscover compassion and the art of gently listening to people in a non-patronizing way, but being able to discuss whatever, nothing should be off limits. We should be able to talk about it in a reasonable way and hear one another out. And a sense of wonder at the beauteous nature of the world, which is not just a foregone mechanism. These things would ultimately alter the way in which we experience life. And I think that we need to be gravitating towards them as fast as we can. Recovering civility, teaching children in school how to negotiate, how to argue two sides of a question, how to arbitrate between warring parties, how to do something that is normally only taught to people too late in life when their marriage is on the rocks, which is how to talk to another person and hear what it is they're saying. So, you know, in couple counselling, there's a thing you do where you say, no, you say what it is. You'll have your moment in a minute. Let him speak or let her speak. And when that's finished, then the other person's allowed to reply. But the first thing they must do is to say back what it is they've heard the other person say. And very often that is so revealing, because you find that there was a misconception. That wasn't what they were saying at all. And so there is common ground. And finding that common ground is what we need. So, I don't know the answer to these things. I can give pointers. I can give hope. I can say we only are asked not to solve massive problems on our own, to cooperate with others towards ends we believe in, and to bring integrity into our own lives, and as much as possible avoid saying things we know to be wrong, and avoid furthering things that will restrict freedom and restrict the expression of beauty, and re-sophisticate our idea of what good is, which comes from the heart. It's not following rules. It's not ticking boxes. It's about something that's in here, a disposition of the soul.
Mm. Well, much of that sounds like ancient wisdom. And I think maybe one of the, I hope, well, I've observed this already in telling people about your work and in talking with people who are already familiar with it, is that this placing this understanding of the dual hemispheres gives us in itself a myth, a story to understand this through. So I could say to people, listen to the good. But that doesn't make sense to people now. Yeah. But I think to say maybe we can work from our right hemisphere for a while with all of the attached meanings to that is actually, it is in itself a way into all of the things which you're saying, which we can all agree with, but we don't have a central symbol to discuss it through. And I hope that your work is actually giving that to people. Are you seeing that in, are you seeing some impact of your ideas in the world when you talk?
It's hard to judge because, of course, to some extent, the people that I encounter are going to be the people who are more open to it. But I certainly do get a colossal amount of feedback that is so heartening to me because I never foresaw that by writing, I thought about an interesting topic that some people would fix on and say, yeah, interesting, maybe we should investigate this more. I thought basically it would all be forgotten, but that it hasn't been and that people see the meaning that I'm trying to propagate is extraordinarily heartening. And I think young people in particular are more open to this. The people who are a problem are the established, smug intellectuals with, they know, they're practically all white and they think they know what's best for people of all races and people of different sexes and so on. So they think they know, and the story is a played out story. And what we're experiencing is a conflict between an enforced ideology, which these people insist on, and what our heart is telling us. And that's a very uncomfortable place to be. And I think that's what's causing a lot of the grief, the fear, the panic, the anxiety, the stress, and the gloom. If we could find a world in which people spoke recognizable truths to us again, this would be wonderful. I mean, because one's heart sings when one hears something that one can respond to and that one knows in one's heart is right. I mean, you say people don't know where to go for truth, but I think they kind of do, because they can see the big picture with their right hemisphere, and they can see the way in which this is being discussed and unpacked, and they can see in it something different from what it is they're being served up all the time and worrying about. So I am, in that sense, a hopeful pessimist, as I often say. I'm hopeful in the sense that I always have great hope in humanity. You don't know what they'll come up with. They're amazingly resourceful. They're wonderful beings, actually. One of the things I'm very opposed to is the constant derogation of humanity. Yes, of course, we've made an almighty cock-up. That's absolutely true. And there's lots of things we've done that we would now not do in that way. But there is something amazing about human beings. If we can live in harmony with the rest of the natural world, there's no reason why we shouldn't. In fact, that's what we need to be encouraging ourselves to do. So, yes, I am hopeful, very hopeful, of what will come forth. It will come forth from young people, because young people are less indoctrinated. You know, Max Planck famously said, science moves forward a funeral at a time. It's not that you convince the oldies who hold the power that you've got something to say. It's the young people who say it. And there are lots of researchers now who write to me, where can I go where I can research your things and so on? I'm not really sure, but anywhere that's got an open enough mind, you've got to be able to find people who will welcome you in their midst.
I have a feeling much more is going to form around your work.
That's lovely.
The next few years, I certainly hope so. Iain, can I thank you for joining me, and also thank you for your work, which has had a big influence on me.
Thanks, David.
Over the last few years.
No, thanks for having me along. I've thoroughly enjoyed talking, and I'm very glad that my work resonates with you and means something to you, as I am to so many people who please carry on writing. Don't feel I've heard it too many times. I can never hear it enough, but people write and tell me. That's very good. Thank you.